We are open our Bible in the book of Leviticus, chapter 17, verse 11. Leviticus, chapter 17, verse 11. This is our verse that we're going to read. Chapter 17, verse 11. We're waiting if everyone have it. Chapter 17 of Leviticus, verse 11. It says, "For the life of the flesh is in the blood, and I have given it to you upon the altar to make an atonement for your souls. For it is the blood that maketh an atonement for the soul." This is very important. Before we continue with your, with our study, I like to share with you some experience, little experience from Brazil. And right now the World Cup is going on. Everybody is watching football. And do you know we were working in São Paulo, one of the biggest cities in South America, Brazil. 17 million inhabitants. And during the night, you can, when we were working, sometimes we travel to the city, you can see young kids, 10, 11, 14 years, that use drugs on the street, all over, thousands, millions. Do you know what's happened before the World Cup start? You can imagine. Strangers are coming, tourists are visiting Brazil for the World Cup, and the government come to the decision that these young people will be a problem for the World Cup, for those people who visit Brazil, and we need a solution with those young kids. Who Jesus has shed his blood for them also. And do you know what they did? During the night, a truck with police will go into the streets, in the truck, and then drive them and bury them. Could you imagine that? Thanks God for America that we don't have such things. Sometimes we don't have an idea the privilege that we have living here in America. I will share with you one quotation of Sister White that we will find. I will share with you the where you will find it. It is in the book. It is in Letters 108, 18. 99. And I'm gonna share this with you so that we can meditate on the blood of Christ. The blood that Christ shed for the remission of sin. Those young guys, young people in Brazil, their blood has been shed just for people to look to football. And that game is not sport, it's not recreation, but it is amusement. Letters 108, 1899, it says, "The atoning sacrifice is full and sufficient. It is the new covenant sealed with his blood, which was shed for many for the remissions of sin. This Christ declared at the Last Supper. In this cup there is to those who drink in faith peacemaking, soul cleansing, efficacy. It is the balm of Gilead, which God has provided to restore health and soundness to the sin-stricken soul. Is this a blessing? I'd like to share with you another story, little story just recent ago. I was in Brazil, and a brother told me that he had experience just some months ago. He was on the way to the church, and he met on the road. It was almost night, and he met a man like 50 and 60 years, and he was have long beard, and he asked him, "Do you know where it is a Seventh-day Adventist church in this area?" He says, "Yes, I'm going to the Seventh-day Adventist church right now." And he asked him, "Did you 7 days accept people with beard in the church?" He says, "No problem. You can come and we accept people with beards, no problem." He said, "Okay, we'll go and visit your church." And do you know who was this person? It was a Catholic priest. And he said he listened to the message. And when he finished, they walked out and we walked together. And this priest told this brother that he was studying his Bible. And he come to understand Jesus Christ, who shed his blood for the remission of sin. And do you know what this priest did? One Sunday morning, he wake up, he have the service, he stand on the pulpit, and he tell the members, there is no Trinity, there is no adoration of Mother Mary. He spoke straight to against the doctrine of the Catholic Church. And that was his last sermon. And the story continued, and they talk with him, the leader of the church, and they tell them that you have to visit Vatican. Vatican is waiting for you in Rome. You have to go there. You don't have to preach anymore. We don't like to tell nobody anything, and we will prepare everything for you to be in the Vatican, because you have to speak there and you have to defend yourself before the Vatican. And he gave the brother a check, and he tell the brother, "I know that I'm not gonna live long. This check, you can use it, because you guys are preaching the truth. You can use this check because I'm going to Rome and I can use it." And the brother handed him a book, Great Controversy. And he told this brother, "Before I reach Rome, I will read this book and finish it before." And he did. And do you know, after some weeks that he went to back, he went to Rome, the brother went on the computer and he find his name, and he says, he is not living anymore. He died. But they don't give the reason why he died. And you know the check that he had, he just have a lawyer, a friend of him who was a lawyer, and he go to the lawyer and he asked the lawyer if he can help them, you know, to get this money from the bank. And then the lawyer take the check, he look to it, and he tell him, "Do you know, you can see this check? Do you see the seal here? Do you know the seal of whom is this seal? It is the seal of Rome. And there is no lawyer that can take no case against Rome and not defend nothing from Rome." And he told this brother, "If you want to live, just hide this check and keep it away. Don't try to change it, because you will lose your life." That is Rome. That's the spirit of Rome. And brothers and sisters, it is high time for us to examine our life. Amen. Because the United States once was a Protestant country, but not anymore. Soon we will be forced, our conscience will be forced, whom we will serve. And in this special service, the communion service, I want each of us to meditate and to be sure if we know Jesus. Do you know Jesus was the best? Jesus was a divine teacher. He spent more than 3 years with the apostles, teaching them. But my question is, did they really understand or was had the conviction that Jesus was the Son of God? Can you think about this? Now coming closer, we today, in 2014, are we really convinced that Jesus is the Son of God and that we know Jesus? Are we sure? And I would just like to meditate a little bit in the book of Desires of Ages. It's a book that every day I spend half an hour or an hour studying the life of Jesus, because it is by contemplating Jesus that we will be transformed. Amen. By the image of Jesus, reflect his character. And I just like to share this briefly with you. In Desires of Ages, page 666, it says, "If you had known me," Christ said, "you should have known my Father also. And from henceforth, ye know him and have seen him." But not yet did the disciple understand. "Lord, show us the Father," exclaimed Philip, "and it's sufficient us." And it continued and says, amazed at his dullness of comprehension, the divine teacher was with the apostles. Christ asked with pained surprise, "Have I been so long time with you, and yet hast thou not know me, Philip?" And today, before the communion service, we have to ask ourselves this question. I have been so long time in the Seventh-day Adventist Church, and still I don't know Jesus? And Jesus continued, "Is it possible that you do not see the Father in the works he does through me?" Do you not believe that I came to testify of the Father? How sayest thou then, show us the Father? He that hath seen me hath seen the Father. And it says, Christ had not ceased to be God when he became man. Though he had humbled himself to humanity, the Godhead was still his own. Christ alone could represent the Father to humanity, and this representation the disciples had been privileged to behold for over 3 years. 3 years with the divine teacher. And when Jesus asked Peter in John, in Matthew 16, who they say that the Son of Man are? Did the people know about who Jesus was? Did Peter know who Jesus was? Did Peter was convinced that who Jesus was? In John chapter 8, when Jesus was talking with the Jews, the people of his time, did they know who Jesus is and who Jesus was and who was the Father? Say not. Is it possible today, in our time, that those who has come out of the local churches, the Seventh-day Adventist organization, if it's possible that we still don't know who Jesus is, I will share with you just brief some experience. We went down in Brazil, I am Barbara Morgan. We had a hard time helping the people to know who Jesus is. Most people down there, most of the brothers and sisters who just come out from the church because of the Trinity doctrine, most of them don't know who Jesus is. When you tell the people that Jesus is God, they say, no, Jesus is not God, Jesus is the Son of God. Don't say that Jesus is God. And we were praying and asking God how to teach these people in a simple way who Jesus is. And brothers and sisters, if we know that Jesus is the Son of God, we know also that Jesus is God. Amen. And we try to help the people down in Brazil, help them to understand who Jesus is, because this is very important. If we put two categories, God and his creatures, under who category Jesus will be?
The divine.
God or Father? The divine category. And we don't know any other category than the creature, those who God create. They are creatures. We as human beings have been created by God. So animals, plants, and the animal kingdom, all are being created. But if Jesus is not God, under what category he come then? Just created. And then we have a Jehovah Witnesses doctrine. But Jesus is God. And they tell me, don't tell the people that Jesus is God here in Brazil. I say, well, you are 192 million people. But if I have to lift up Jesus before you alone, I will do that. And tell you that Jesus is the Son of God. And my brothers and sisters, it is high time for us to let people know who Jesus is. And then I will just move a little bit forward in the book of Desires of Ages to let you know when the disciples really understand who Jesus was. And this will be the experience for us also to meditate and study and to be sure that we know Jesus. Yes, after the Lord's ascension, the disciples realize the fulfillment of his promise. The scenes of the crucifixion, resurrection, and ascension of Christ were a living reality to them. And then they saw that the prophecies had been literally fulfilled. They searched the scriptures, John 5:39, and accepted their teaching with a faith and assurance unknown before. They knew that the divine teacher was all that he claimed to be. As they told their experience and exalted the love of God, men's hearts were melted and subdued, and multitude believed on Jesus. It is until they search the scripture for themselves that they understand who Jesus was. And it tells us that the success of our work is to ask Jesus, John 16:24. As yet, the disciples were unacquainted with the Savior's unlimited resources and power. He said to them, "Hitherto have ye asked nothing in my name." He explained that the secret of their success would be in asking for strength and grace in his name. Every sincere prayer is heard in heaven. I may not be fluent expressed, but if the heart is in it, it will ascend to the sanctuary where Jesus ministers. And where are Jesus ministering right now in the sanctuary? In the most holy place. and he will present it to the Father with an outward, stammering word, but beautiful and fragrant with the incense of his own perfection. My brothers and sisters, we are moving forward for this communion service, and as I said, it is more serious than the Supreme Court, because the Supreme Court just deal with cases here on earth, but all the judges in the Supreme Court, all the lawyers, one day have to stand before the great white throne.
That's right. Amen. Amen.
And the Ten Commandments will be there. And it is only the blood of Jesus. It is Jesus alone, the atonement, the sin, the blood of Jesus that can give us peace, that can give us sound mind, that can give us rest in Jesus. May God bless us as we move forward for the communion service.